Even with the reading of the manuscript, people don't get it anymore, because I think we don't paint for the same reasons anymore. I think the philosophy behind the painting and the purpose behind the painting is very different. The modern artist is trying to say something which is personal and a very personal perspective, and he uses the same symbols, but he uses them very differently. Whereas when you are looking at these paintings, most of this painting is mystic poetry or kalam, and the context of the word is heavily weighted in the direction of, you know, something that is leading you inward. So you are using that vocabulary with that purpose. Today you use the technique, but you don't have the same underlying inspiration or philosophy or purpose. So it evolved with a particular purpose and function. Today that function has been distorted, mostly as mere words that you use to express, to communicate.
You said that the Herat school was heavily sort of
influenced by the Sabur. Yes, Jami, Hazrat Jami.
So the actual artists, you know, hum kehte hain ki ya aap Ainul Yaqeen ke stage pe aap, matlab Ainul Yaqeen pe rehte hain. So were they at that level that they were able to, you know, develop such imagery so accurately?
I think that's such a beautiful question, because I think they weren't just painting. So they were studying texts first, and they were studying texts with people who were writing those texts. So the influence of those people on their emotional, physiological, psychic, you know, channels was huge.
So they must have been evolved to quite.
They were evolved to quite an extent, yes. And it's how much they understood what they were reading and how they were able to express it. And then they were not just painting to prove who they were, because none of these paintings are signed. A lot of it is conjecture today that this belongs to so and so, or this was worked by so and so, because you eliminate yourself from that communication, because the purpose of that communication is not to say, oh, I'm a great artist. But there is this culture in which you are painting and you're taking years to paint for a series of paintings that will go into one book. And then you are being supervised by the scholars, and the work has to be again approved by the king himself, who is funding the project. And you've started working at a very young age, and you've been working for years, and you have been exposed to this art for years. So all your aesthetics have been shaped by looking at these paintings. So often you can compare paintings which are from different manuscripts on the same subject, and you'll see just subtle changes. Maybe because they felt that the original was good enough. Today we would probably say, oh, it's just a copy. It's only when you get down to painting one of these paintings, even if you're copying, that you really appreciate what it takes to make one of these pieces. And with all the tools that we have in hand, which means we're not making our paper, and we're not processing our color, and we're not creating our own tools, and we have all the technology and all the light to sit and work in.
Obviously, a lot of their inner beauty was translated into
that. Yes. Their training, their understanding, the influences around them. And I mean, a lot of these artists weren't just bound, say, to Herat. Those from Herat traveled to Tabriz, and from Tabriz they traveled to Delhi. And they took with them what they learned, and you see the flowering of this art in different periods, and it's sort of almost a different vocabulary, a different environment from which, I mean, particularly under Akbar, you have Hindu painters who are inducted into the atelier and who are taught this art form. And they have a totally different mizaj and mood to the way they paint.
did their sort of religious symbolism also enter into the art?
Well, you have a very, very, what is the word for it, egalitarian environment under Akbar, and he encourages all kinds of expression, and it's like a melting pot, so the art has that kind of energy too. And it again depends on the piece you're looking at. Is there a manuscript which is literary indicators and more use of symbols?
Basic premise was that, you know, these were sort of, as you said, like a visual language for the manuscript. So what about miniature painting today? Then it means it's a completely different thing.
Look,
it just looks the same. But
you have to understand whether you're looking at miniature painting, visual art, music, poetry, it's just a form of expression. It's one person saying something to people at large, whether you're using words or you're writing the words or you're using visuals or you're doing it in sculpture or you're doing it, you know, in some sort of, you know, in a vessel or a carpet or, you know, embroidery on cloth. All of it is basically a form of self-expression. It's just that it depends on what you're trying to say. So in this case, it was Islamic because it had a very close context to pointing towards your relationship with the divine reality. That is why it comes under the daira of traditional Islamic. But even then, it's not sacred. So within Islamic art, you have two broad categories. One is traditional and one is sacred. And sacred may, it's either calligraphy, which is Quranic calligraphy, or mosque architecture. That comes under purely sacred, which is linked to religious function and directly as the word of God. The rest of it comes under traditional simply because it's pointing towards the same universe, but it's not a direct manifestation. But when you're talking about art in general, it's just entirely up to the person who is trying to convey something for. It's not a product that you hang on walls. It will always reflect something that is the vernacular of that time. So whatever is happening is going to show up in some form or the other through a person's work. But the grammar of a miniature painting is what makes it miniature. It's not necessarily the scale. We think scale because it was art of the book. And it had a very defined function being related to the scale of the manuscript. But today the two have been separated, so the visual vocabulary has become free, and so it can be at any scale. So if the form is stylized and the grammar is the way we use it traditionally, you still come under the idea, the sort of label of contemporary miniature painting. So it's a very powerful tool of communication, is what you're trying to say. Ultimately, any art holds, it depends on the quality of what the artist is trying to put out there.
And they would have had very limited audiences?
It's a courtly art. It's a courtly art. It was always, the atelier or the library was always open to all the people who were part of a particular court. They had access to it. Yes, but masses didn't have access to it. I mean, in the beginning, even the written word was not open to everybody because everybody was not literate. And most of the time, the kalam was being passed orally in society, heart to heart. So this was just a preservation of that knowledge. And how many books can you produce if you're making them by hand? It wasn't until printing processes came that you had mass publications. That by then the artist was no longer part of an atelier and no longer the prized part of the king's court. He had to go and fend for himself. Then he had to create a product that he could sell. That's where individualism starts to come in, and then you have signed paintings.
The role of the artist changes, no?
And the purpose of the art and the function of the art change.
The cosmological universe that we saw, especially in the first one, I'm reading Paradiso these days, and it's not obviously the same, but it's quite sort of, you can see the
different different labels, but
but you don't see it that strongly depicted in their art.
again, it depends.
Obviously, the poets were engaging with it.
It depends again which period you're looking at, because you know medieval art to sara is patronized by the church, so it had a very specific purpose. And you see so many, you know, nativity scenes, you so many Christ on the cross, you know, elements which they needed to get across. Again, not everybody was literate, so the visual vocabulary helped. But later on, the artist, the Renaissance, which is 1600 onwards, the artist has been released from that bondage and he is free to express himself. So again, the subject matter changes.
But it becomes very human focused. It still doesn't go towards.
So this cosmic map in art is your own map, na? So the mulk is the equivalent of your jism, and the malakut is the equivalent of your soul, and the realms above it is the spiritual realm. So it's basically like looking at a mirror and being reminded that what are you. So it was always reinforcing that with subtlety. It's true that you look at Islamic architecture, it's the same vocabulary. If you look at the tile work, you look at rock printing, the carpet design, and they all emerge from geometry, geometric forms. Aur unke bhi teen fundamentals ABC, the circle, the square, and the rect, the triangle. The circle represents divinity, and all of calligraphy emerges from the circle. The proportion emerges from the circle. The Taj Mahal was designed with a compass. And the square represents the physical material, this realm. And the triangle represents man in all his three aspects. So the rotated square is time and space, which is this realm. And the six-sided star represents the descent of knowledge and the ascent of man through his intellect, as the Star of David. So this vocabulary, when you combine it in different ways, there are infinite possibilities, and depends on the artist, how he's trying to and what he's trying to say.
But something in our religion specifically translated into this vocabulary, and even though they obviously had an idea of this cosmological reality, their evolution was very, collective evolution was very different.
Once you have this development of artificial perspective, which is the third dimension, then the whole focus of the viewer is shifted to the skill and the ability to replicate the physical material world.
Because that's what you can see.
Yes, and then you're looking at the man in 3D. Whereas in the miniature art, it's a deliberate disconnect. If they would do that, then they're merely replicating the material, which is not what they're trying to do. It's sort of against the purpose of the art, in conflict with the purpose of the art. That's why the stylization, that's why the use of symbols, that's why the layering of meaning, that's why the arrangement of form and the designing is totally from a different perspective. That's why the use of geometry to set the proportion so that it has that perfect proportion. And that's why every inch of space is treated at the same level of fineness in work, even if it's a tiny bit of a cloud or it's the eye of a king or the face of a king. There's no sense of, you know, this area the artist actually worked on and this area is just left incomplete. No. And those of you who are in the class know that when you're doing the background, which is the void, it takes up all your time. But by the time you finish that, the rest of the painting feels like a piece of cake.
Piece of cake? No.
The miniature painter is forced into treating every centimeter with the same respect.
How would that translate into like your reality?
Look, the process of painting is also a learning curve. So it's a refinement of the human being, or the refinement of the nafs. It's a fine tuning of your senses. So if you're going to spend hours first sharpening your pencil and sanding it and learn how to control that line at a very fine level, And then when you sit down to paint, you have to get your colors in just the right, you know, balance with each other. And you have to, when you start laying the color and how many layers of color that you put in and how many hours that you put into it and what state of mind you are, because if you become totally absorbed in your work, then you forget where you are. Your time is suspended. And that quality is what is basically how you are able to perceive your inner universe. That's the gateway. So they train you to slow down and not fight a timeline and not look at it as a product with a value attached to it. Then you're looking to push for perfection up to where you can take it personally. So it's like peace when it finishes is way beyond what you would have imagined it if you are trying to take it to its nth level. If you're taking it up to where you planned it, okay, this is what I'm going to do, and now I've done it, and now it's good enough, it can sell. That's a different perspective. Then you will not go beyond yourself. You won't push the sound barriers. That's why they were always encouraged for excellence, and that's why those people training them gave them ample room to start at a very young age and explore.
And the difference is they were paid in gold and stuff.
They weren't worried about what they would
they
be.
They
were well paid, they were well looked after, their families were looked after. That was not the issue. Yes, and they were inducted at a young age and paid from a young age. So the learning time is also labor that was accounted for and paid for. So you came out of that system with a skill which would earn, but you didn't have to pay to learn.
They were lucky.
Yes, they were lucky at many levels.
I have to paint to them and then paint to them.
Then, yes, exactly. Plus, today the student is not willing to put in that kind of hours for a painting. They want instant coffee.
Exactly.
So they'll get instant coffee. Different experience to have instant coffee, and it's a whole different experience to have coffee which has been ground and brewed, and it's a different experience. It's free will. Who decide on what you want to do and how you want to shape your life. I mean, whether you are looking at this art form, or you're looking at architecture, or you're looking at, you know, calligraphy, all of these art forms are refining all those senses in exactly the same way. And you can't jump, you know, there's no one step that you can miss. There are no shortcuts in this process. The end effect will be compromised.
But how can you make Winchell more popular this day?
It doesn't require to be popular. It needs to be experienced and enjoyed. So if you are interested in looking at those paintings, they will reveal themselves. But my job here is to make you realize that there is more to them than meets the eye.
It seems to me the real purpose of function of these traditional arts, especially with something like miniature, is more than illustration. It's more than elaborating something. The real purpose probably lies in the training your own soul.
It is.
It's like some meditative
practice. All traditional arts were done with this fundamental underlying process,
right,
of the refinement of the nafs.
So the primary purpose that's really serving is that the artist himself becomes like a saintly.
Yes. Through a lifetime of practice.
So more soul is training their own souls rather than actually trying to say something to the public.
It is a two-way communication.
Yeah, that is becomes a secondary.
Yes. And then if you have a society that totally understands the word, understands the Quran, understands the mystic poetry that refers to the Quran like the Masnavi, and then looks at visual images, and then there is discussion on it, that is a kind of environment that is lifting everybody, and it's feeding everybody at the intellectual level and at the deeper level. When you're talking about good music, there's nothing wrong in good music if the words do something for you. And if you're listening to really harsh music, then that's what it will do to you. It's again choice, free will. And each of these is decisions made by men. There were men who decided to paint like this. And there were men who wrote the words that were illustrated like this.
Especially something like miniature, compared to something like poetry, for example. Poetry is accessible generally to more masses, but miniature would be very courtly. It's
a courtly art.
So it's like compared to like folk music, it's like classical music.
It wasn't something that was made with a perspective to be sold. It was something that was commissioned. And then it was meant to be shared or gifted. Even when it was gifted, it was shared. So it was going to be read in a darbar or in a court, and there would be an audience for it. And there would be an audience for it to be passed around and enjoyed. So it was part of a culture. I mean, today the culture is that you go to an art gallery to look at art. It's just a different modus operandi. And even if you were looking at the book, somebody would be reciting the poetry or the text. So there was that whole environment that was created. Today you gather together and you ask somebody's out for dinner, the general conversation can be anything from politics to gossip. I mean, maybe we need something to link us back to something that is that has an impact at a deeper level on us. And most of us have sold all these books to the Western world for very little money, or I should say for money. And they have it, they are writing about it, and they appreciate and have preserved it better than we have. We would have, I should say. Again, it's just a closing of the mind of and of the intellect, because we do not value it anymore. And most of our art institutions say this is just copy work. It's just a craft.
When and how did it detach from its original...
I think 16th century onwards, when you have printing presses and you have books being published, and the need to preserve knowledge through handmade manuscripts becomes more of a passion with certain rulers who are still willing to fund the atelier, and the artist is no longer, you know, the most wanted commodity in society, because you mean there were khattats, illuminators, and painters and designers of architecture and gardens. I mean, they were the creative people, and suddenly the creativity as far as the book and painting went became sort of contained, because there was another medium, technology took over. So today we are looking at Kindle, we're not looking at the printed text.
So the painting transitioned into portraits before?
The paintings, if you are looking at miniature painting, up to a point, you still have the court commissioning, which is, I think, up to early 1600s, 1700s. You still have ateliers at work.
I thought Ranjit Singh had it there.
Some of them do. Some of them right up to the 1800s, because I think subcontinent may printing presses came later. It wasn't so much the vogue, and there were still passionate people who wanted handmade books and still valued handmade manuscripts. So there was still production of them, but I don't think it was at the same scale.
Didn't ask the Hindu Rajputs and have their...
They did. Right up to 1850s you have, and then you have the British period, which is the colony period, yeah. Again, there was book art being commissioned, but they were not necessarily part of a manuscript. They're sold very quick sketches. You won't see full-scale detailed paintings of the same quality, because the materials also deteriorated. They weren't using the same kind of colors, pigments, paper, gold leaf. They're using lapis lazuli, and they're using 24-karat gold leaf. It wasn't available. And if it was, then somebody would commission something like that, and they would be able to produce it.
Can those things still be made? I mean, lapis lazuli, if you have
Some of the techniques are being sort of started, but I haven't seen anybody produce the stone colors yet. Mineral colors are back. A lot of gold leaf is back. A lot of people doing it and a lot of people teaching it. The Prince's School of Arts in London has brought back a lot of the old earth pigments and mineral vegetable pigment techniques. In here, for us in Lahore, it was a treat that we had Bashir Ahmed, who taught at NCA for almost 30 years. And he learned from Sheikh Shuja'ullah and Haji Sharif, who were people who linked back to the old Mughal families who worked in the royal ateliers. So those techniques came down generation to generation, and then they became part of the modern academic curriculum and they got taught. So a lot of people learned it. That's why people like us are sitting here doing it. And also because it became very popular in the West. These techniques was not something familiar to them, and they were greatly appreciated. And you had Imran Qureshi's and Shazia Sikandar's make it big. So more people were interested in learning this technique and this art form. So there is a revival. But I think that until we don't, as an audience, appreciate it, and we don't ask for it to be commissioned, some of the more classical images will not be around in the future, as they were repeatedly done over the generations.
So it's a revival, but divorced from its origins.
Yes.
The context has changed.
But the vocabulary hasn't.
The context of the art has changed.
But the vocabulary doesn't change. I mean, if you're going to paint a tree with a disciple or a hermit, it is implying the same thing. It's talking about the same subject matter. It's just whether you realize it or you don't realize it.
But neither the artist nor the audience now has the same sort of nuanced understanding of it.
But the nuanced understanding of it is because man has become very focused on a very rational, secular pathway. No? He's lost perspective on who he is. And he is so busy looking at the material plane, and everything has become a product. For that reason, you're not seeking this art. But if you were looking beyond yourself and you're looking for a bridge or an experience or a source that could add something to your inner vision and your own quest for self-discovery, then you would want to spend time with these images, or you would want to spend time with such poetry, or you would want to pursue looking at these things in museums, take out the time to do it. Because it's actually your own choice. What are you wanting to see, or what are you wanting to listen to, or what are you wanting to do? I mean, you've come here for a purpose, because it's adding something to your own understanding of yourself. And you only appreciate the work now more because you've suddenly had an insight into what it is showing you. So now you go back to it, and it is just another way of looking into yourself. It's looking into the imaginal realm or imaginal consciousness, and understanding that even words emerge from your thoughts and letters emerge from the same realm. Even they are not man created, and they're very powerful symbols that carry meaning, and the mouth organ belongs to man that can articulate those sounds, and it is the ears that hear it and the intellect that processes it and adds or converts it into meaning. So ultimately, it's all about man. And most of traditional Islamic art will always refer you back to yourself. They're just subtle, beautiful ways of doing it. We take speech for granted.
So it speaks to you only as much as you yourself are evolved, or not?
Yes. And to choose to be evolved or not is free will. How do you want to spend your time? What do you want to read? How does it inform you? How does it add to the experience of life?